what we are going to talk about. We are going to talk about certain basic things which are required to be understood by a teacher who is also supposed to be a guide for a research study. Because you are here, you are expected to guide the students as well, because this is the PG institution. Many of you may already be guiding some students as a guide or as a co-guide, or many of you, if not yet guiding, maybe in coming years you are going to take the students for the proper guidance. So again, as we talked about the teaching, it's a great responsibility. Becoming a research guide is also another great responsibility which you need to understand. A lot of things are required to be understood by a research guide. Research, becoming a research guide doesn't really mean that you have a servant to serve you, to help you all the time for all your own personal requirements. But you have a responsibility to serve the society by means of that student. What I used to speak about this thing, I used to say that becoming a guide or becoming a research guide gives you an opportunity to live your dream. You might have got a dream in your mind of doing something excellently in some particular area, but because of certain reasons you couldn't do it. There might be a lot of reasons you couldn't do it. Now this is your turn to live that dream again by means of the help of your student. I mean, you can materialize that dream which you had in your mind with the help of your student. So what happens in PG studies, PG researches or PhD studies, basically these researches are not the ideas of the student. And they should not be. They should not be the idea of the student. Most of the times, it is the idea of the research guide who guides sometimes. Most of the times they guide. And if you are able to conceive the idea properly, you can really do some excellent research in that area. And if you take it casually, as we do in the teaching also, if you do it casually, probably nothing good is going to happen. Nothing good is going to happen to Ayurveda if you take it casually and if you do not move seriously in this area. So we are going to talk about certain norms which are to be observed by a research guide, the expected guide, or those who are still at the moment they are guiding the students. And we are going to see that what are the norms which are to be followed while conceiving or while designing the researches. Again, let me congratulate you for accomplishing your long cherished dream. Many of us might have dreamed to become a guide, a research guide. Now it is your turn. You are here. You are a guide now or expecting to become soon. This is your turn to get fumed yet respected. You can expect a lot of respect by means of becoming a guide. So getting ready for the start. Okay, you are a guide now. What is expected from you and how you are gearing up, how you are preparing yourself to become a guide? Okay, there can be number of ways to prepare yourself. There are number of books which are available supervising PhD students. You can take the help of this kind of material which is available over the net supervising the PhD. There are certain guides. You need to understand who are your competitors in this area. I mean, if you are not really a good guide, who is going to compete you in the field? This may be your competitor. If you are not really a good guide, your student, the poor guys, may land up to these places for asking some kind of help. So be aware that it really means to become a good research guide, or else you need to be, I mean, your students are going to be there. So need to understand who can be your competitor. Huh? Okay, you can take a pick. It was very interesting, and I thought that it would be very, very pertinent to present it here in the lecture. Okay, so to begin with, get acquainted with the customs of research. I mean, where to begin? The first thing which you need to understand is get acquainted with the customs of the research. What are the basic customs of research? These customs, you need to understand what are the customs of research in your own organization. You are here in BHU, I am there in State Ayurvedic College, Lucknow. The people can be from somewhere else. You need to identify that what are your own customs. As Dr. Murthy was talking about, you need to personalize the things or you need to customize the things as per your own need. So there is a possibility that you might be having different priorities than I am. I might be having different priorities. Your institution might be having different priorities than what I do have. So you need to understand what are your institutional policies and priorities, if there are any. Most of the places, at most of the Ayurvedic colleges, they do not have any policies like this. But if at all they have any policy or any priority, you need to identify institutional trends of research. What kind of activities had already been taken up by the institute? That also you need to understand, because many times lot of resistance is going to be faced if you do not follow the trend. Many times it happens that in Lucknow it happens. Most of the times it happens. When I say that we need to require a lot of observational studies, the people are very, very non-cooperative. I mean, for them, research is what? Research means the clinical trial. For every Ayurveda student who is doing PhD or MD, the research means either it is, if they are the non-clinical people, either it is going to be a literary research. They would be identifying the contribution of this and this and this in that area. This is going to be one research, or the another research could be a drug trial. Simple drug trial. You are going to identify a regimen or identifying a sort of intervention, and you would be making a clinical trial in certain area. Unfortunately, most of us do not really understand that there are number of research styles and number of research designs which are very, very pertinent to be done in Ayurveda. You really require a lot of observational studies to be done, and these studies do not require any resource. I mean, they simply require a thought which has to come to your mind, and you can do it. It's very easy. I faced a lot of resistance in my college when I proposed these kind of researches, because they told that these researches have never been done. And what we do, I mean, this clinical research makes a sense. We need to identify the medicines or interventions for those kind of conditions. I simply have replied that for last 50 years, you people are doing the same kind of research. I mean, for last 30, 35 years, we are running Kai Chikitsa PG in Ayurvedic College for last 35 years. So I simply have reiterated or simply have told that we are doing this research for last 35 years, and just tell me the outcome. What you have really contributed to the society for doing these own researches for last 35 years? I mean, are you able to identify a single formulation which is available in the market, which has been researched by you or in this college, at this college? So, no. But they are doing it because it is a trend. They are doing it because they see that this is only this composes the kind of research which is to be required or which is to be done by an Ayurveda student. So you need to expand your horizon. You need to understand that what else lies besides what is being done there. You need to understand it well. So there can be institutional trends of research. There can be institutional resources of research also. You need to understand that what kind of resources. You might conceive a wonderful kind of a study, but if you do not have the resources, who is going to do it? I mean, who is going to help you for that research? You may plan a wonderful research, but you need to identify that whether you really have, or you have a sort of acquaintance or networking with those kind of resources which are going to help you conducting that research. So that is also something very important which you need to understand. Then after, we need to understand what are the academic regulatory agencies are saying, what are their regulations. There are academic regulations. For example, we have regulations of CCIM, we have regulations of individual universities. Your university might be having their own regulations of research. UGC is having certain regulations of its own. So you need to know about what academic regulations are saying about the research. This is also something important which everyone has to understand before you start planning any research. And then you need to understand what the research regulatory agencies are saying about research. I mean, what we have talked about, this academic regulatory agencies, CCIM. CCIM is not the research agency. CCIM is the academic regulatory agency. But then you need to understand what this research regulatory agency is saying. For example, the ICMR, or for example, the Ministry of Ayush, this ASU research guidelines, what they are saying about, do they have something specific to say? So you need to get acquainted with all these norms which are going to help you framing a good research. And research registration, this is also you need to understand that every research, irrespective of it is a clinical trial or not, it has to be registered there in the Clinical Trial Registry of India. So that is also one important norm which has to be observed by every guide. And these are the things which are required to be known by every guide. Not your student need not to know about them, but being a guide, you need to understand and you need to know about that. These are the mandatory requirements of framing a research. Okay, let us start talking about what CCIM says about PG research. CCIM, you know that CCIM has a PG regulation, 2016 MSR of PG education. The objective of PG education, CCIM conceives that objective of the PG education is the aim of the postgraduate degree courses shall be to provide orientation of a specialist and super specialist of Ayurveda and to produce experts and specialists who can be competent and efficient teachers, physicians, surgeons, gynecologists, obstetricians, pharmaceutical experts, researchers and profound scholars. This is their objective of giving you a degree of PG in Ayurveda. They see you as a researcher, expert researcher and profound scholar in various fields of specialization of Ayurveda. So this is CCIM MSR says about this. What CCIM further says about PG research, and they have elaborated number of points that what are really required to conceive or to do a PG research. There are 22 points. We are going to talk about them. The first point CCIM says, it is all there in that MSR of PG education 2016. First thing they are saying about that there shall be a central scientific advisory postgraduate committee appointed by CCIM. Unfortunately, we haven't get any such authority up till now. I do not know if it is really existing or not, but it is mentioned there. It is there in that guideline. CCIM shall suggest the area of research and topics every academic year. This is wonderful. I mean, if they can do something like this, if they can make a central agency which can suggest you what are the priority research areas to be taken up this particular year, that can be a wonderful thing. But unfortunately, it is non-existent. It is not existing. But they are saying that to promote evidence-based Ayurveda of global standards, the same shall be followed. The irony with Ayurveda is this, that we talk a lot, we write a lot, but we do very less. I mean, there are very little things which are really there in the practice. But when you look at the guidelines, when you look at the research papers, or when you look at the people speaking about, you'll be finding that they are really talking a lot, or they're really talking aloud, but nothing is really happening at the ground level. So this it is the same example. Okay, the second is the title of the dissertation and the synopsis approved by the IEC shall be submitted to the university within a period of 6 months. Many times this is also not being executed. Many times this period exceeds. In Lucknow also, we do not do it within 6 months of the period. I don't know if it is happening here in BHU or not, but many times it happens that we do not follow this guideline also. But as a guide, you need to understand that your synopsis has to be submitted within 6 months from the date of admission of your student. Failing to this, the term for postgraduate course shall be extended for another 6 months or more in accordance to the time of submission of the synopsis. Depends upon when you are actually submitting it. The further ruling, the synopsis of the proposed scheme of work shall indicate the expertise and action plan of the work of the student relating to the proposed theme of the work. The university shall approve the synopsis not later than 3 months after submission of the synopsis. See, this all is very, very clearly mentioned there. I mean, we never have noticed it, that this all is already mentioned there. Further, it says that a board of research studies shall be constituted by the university for approving the title. The university shall display the approved synopsis of dissertation on their website. This is also something which is recommended by CCIM. And when it is recommended by CCIM, we feel that this is going to be mandatory. I mean, the people have to do it because this is obligatory. This is not that voluntarily you are going to do it. No, it is obligatory and it is mandatory. You need to do it, but nobody does it. Nobody. In Lucknow, at least, it never happens. I do not know what is happening in other universities. Further,
The CCIM says that the subject of every dissertation shall be research-oriented, practical-oriented, innovative and helpful in the development of Ayurveda system. Okay. Once the title of the dissertation is approved by the Board of Research Studies of the university, the student shall not be allowed to change the title of the proposed theme of work without permission of the university. Once it is approved, it is taken up by the university, you have no authority to change it further, unless it is again approved by the university authorities. No student shall be allowed to submit the dissertation before 6 months of completion of the course. I mean, you cannot do it much earlier. You can do it after completion of 2.5 years of your course, but not earlier than that. You can submit your dissertation. The dissertation shall contain the methods and data of the research carried out by the student on the problem selected by him and completed under the guidance of the guide. The dissertation shall consist of critical review of literature. I mean, they are explaining that what it should contain, what should be there in the dissertation. Shall consist of critical review of literature, methodology, result of the research, discussion on the basis of research finding of the study, summary, conclusion and references cited in the dissertation shall be suitable for the publication. The dissertation shall consist of not less than 40,000 words. This is also one mandatory condition which is mentioned there in that guideline, I mean CCIM recommendation. So you need to be watchful that how big your dissertation is. It should be not less than 40,000 words. Further, it says the dissertation shall contain at the end. Please. Logic. The only rationale could be that if you have certain limitation that it should be minimum, these many words are there. I mean, this gives a sense that you might have searched the literature well, possibly. Because when you are searching the literature, there are possibilities that you would be accumulating a lot of information. And that information would be reaching up to that standard. If you do not have that kind of benchmark, the number of words or limitation of the pages, minimum number of the pages or minimum number of the words, there is a possibility that a lot of things are going to be summed up summarily or quickly. I mean, you may not be taking a proper note of those things which are already available in the literature. So there is a requirement. I mean, it may not be 40,000, but there has to be certain norm that it should be at least these many pages or these many words should be there. As it happens in every research publication also, they specify usually that the review article has to be of itne words, the research article has to be of these many words. I mean, if you are trying to submit an article in any journal, they would be specifying you that if it is a research article, it has to be not more than. They are not limiting you for the less than, but they are mentioning that it should not be more than 5,000 words or something like that. So word limitation is always there. Similarly, the dissertation shall contain at the end a summary of about 1,500 words and conclusion of about 1,000 words. Every guide is required to understand that this is how the thesis is to be prepared. The guide or supervisor shall be a person of a status of a professor of reader or associate professor, lecturer or assistant professor having 5 year university approved teaching experience in the subject concerned are eligible to become guide. 5 copies of the bound dissertation along with a certificate from the supervisor or guide shall reach to the office. Okay, 4 months before the final examination. Dissertation shall be assessed by 2 external examiners and 2 internal examiners. Dissertation shall be accepted after the approval of examiners, and in case of disapproval by 1 external examiner, the dissertation shall be referred to 3rd external examiner. If it is not approved by one, it has to be referred to another, approved by the university. If the dissertation is not accepted by 2 external examiners, the same shall be returned to the student. I mean, if both of the external reviewers are not accepting the work which you have done, it has to be returned to the student for the proper amendment in the work, and the student shall resubmit the dissertation after making necessary improvement in the light of examiner's report within a period of 6 months. The student shall be permitted to appear in the final examination of postgraduate degree course only after approval of the dissertation by the examiners. Interdisciplinary research, this is important. Interdisciplinary research, BHU has a lot of possibilities of doing interdisciplinary research, may be done by co-opting the guide or supervisor from the concerned specialty. You cannot do an interdisciplinary research at your own. I mean, in Department of Physiology or in Department of Kai Chikitsa, you cannot make a sort of interdisciplinary research unless you invite the people from other disciplines as well. You need to invite those people as the co-guide or co-supervisors for the work. And if a paraclinical or preclinical subject student takes a thesis, for example, if the non-clinical people are choosing to work in a clinical area, they need to opt someone from the clinical side as a co-supervisor or as a co-guide. This all is said by the CCIM, and it is written as a officially approved mandate of the CCIM, which is available there in CCIM PG Education Norms MSR 2016. Okay, this is something which was already talked by Dr. Murthy this morning, GCP guidelines. GCP guidelines are good clinical practice guidelines. Basically, these are the research guidelines, and research guidelines which are pertaining to the drugs which are from the Ayurveda, Siddha and Yunani, because these three systems are containing certain kind of drug interventions. For that reasons, this guideline is prepared for the ASU drugs. So this is, in summary, it is called as GCP ASU, and this was designed by Ministry of Ayush in 2013. It is already available over the net. If you want, this is the link, you can find it over the net. So it's a very lengthy document. What it says about these guidelines are based on CDSCO document on GCP guidelines 2001 for clinical trials on pharmaceutical products. And what it further says that they should be followed for carrying out all ASU medicine research in India at all stages of drug development, whether prior or subsequent to product registration in India. So this has to be, these guidelines are to be followed primarily by every drug research which is pertaining to Ayurveda, Siddha and Yunani. So the people are required to follow these guidelines.